Good morning. You're all so quiet out there. We're going to give you a chance to read the announcement so I don't have to make the announcements. And also give you a chance to do some praying as well, because we all need that. We are so glad that you have joined us in person here on July 3rd weekend. It's good to see so many of you dressed in your red, white, and blue. We also welcome those who might be watching the live stream this morning or watching a recording later on. Thanks to Jasmine up in the balcony who's taking care of all of that, as well as those that will be down at Praise in the Park at 10 o'clock. We've kind of lost Tyler to Praise in the Park this summer. He's doing all the technology down there and live streaming that as well. So I encourage you all, if you haven't already, to go down to Phoenix Park on a Sunday morning at 10 o'clock and take part in that service along with four other ELCA churches. It's kind of exciting when they all get together, and our attendance has been over 200 down there, so we're really pleased this summer. Well, there are a few announcements, as you have seen on the screen, but not so many for this week as it comes up. But just to make you aware, there are teams that are in session during the summer, and if you would like to join them, we encourage you to do so. The Health and Healing team is meeting this week, Thursday at 6:30. That happens to be the team that does a lot of visitations. And I know some have been surprised at the number of people that we have that are homebound that need to be connected with. And it's not that difficult to do. And if you don't feel comfortable doing communion, you don't have to. But we just like to make a connection with every person that is on our rolls here at Spirit Lutheran. Many of you already are doing that visitation, and we thank you for that. We're going to do a little workshop so that if you feel uncomfortable with that, you certainly can. I know during COVID as well, our foundation took some time, Dave's here, and they took names of people that were maybe over 80, names that we had given them that maybe weren't able to get to church or weren't able to tune into any technology during that time, and they made phone calls. And Dave will tell you that those phone calls still continue, and some of those relationships have been just wonderful that have been developed. So if you are interested in doing any kind of visitation, hooking up with someone, another member, that maybe you can benefit from each other in that. You know, we always talk about as pastors, when we go see someone in the hospital, we go there to cheer them up, but the blessing comes to us after that visit, and that's what's wonderful. And this goes along with our theme for today, so I will continue this later on in the message. Just wanted to start out with that. So let you know that's all taking place. July 11th is another time for connection. Out here in the narthex, coffee and conversation. Anyone who wants to just come and have a cup of coffee and visit with people, get to know some other people, can do that. It's on a Monday at 9:30. Welcome to do that. Other things in the bulletin, you'll notice backpacks, school supplies are coming up, Lutheran World Relief, as well as We Care Eau Claire is an organization that is putting together backpacks for thousands of students here in the Eau Claire area. And they are in need of backpacks, also donations, because they're buying a lot of those supplies that they're getting at wholesale this year rather than having everyone bring in all kinds of supplies. But take a look at that as well. A couple of you were talking in the back about the golf outing coming up, August 7th, Spirit Golf Outing. Sign up by the end of the month. Just let us know. We're excited to have that happen again. And there's also a picnic going on July 20th that's a Wednesday evening from 6 to 9, congregational picnic at Lake Altoona Park. That's something new that the Faith Formation Group has come up with. So lots of exciting things. I won't even mention the border battle coming up on the 13th, the Brewers against the Twins at Target Field. There's a bus going to that. Some of you may be going, but we can cheer on from the background if we want to as well with that border battle. So with no further ado, are there any other joys or concerns? You know, there's kind of a joy sitting right here. I don't know if it's a joy or a concern, but Jack has a birthday on Saturday. And it's a birthday that it's like 90, isn't it? Yeah, 90 on Saturday. Happy birthday, Jack. Anyone else that I'm missing? We want to say thank you to Carol for playing that grand piano so grand, as she always does. We sure appreciate that. And we do have a few visitors with us this morning. May you find the hand of friendship here at Spirit as we gather together. If you'd like to leave your name, you certainly can sign up back there. There's a gift for you as well if you would like to take that with you. And we do have coffee and homemade treats. I saw them come in this morning with Cheryl. So you're welcome right after the service to go downstairs. There's a stairway there, or there's an elevator right out in front, and join us for coffee and fellowship this morning on this 4th of July weekend. Well, let us worship God. Let's take a moment to get things right with God, if you will. Take a moment to confess those things that we're not always so proud of, that we might say or we might do. Confess those things that we could have done to make someone feel just a little bit better. Let's take a moment for our confession and forgiveness. Would you please stand as you are able? Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen. Our opening hymn, Lord, You Give the Great Commission. Thank you. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for all the gifts of the Spirit that you have given to all the people of this place. We ask, O Lord, that those gifts can be put to use to further your kingdom so that we can know what it means to freely love one another like Jesus loves. We talk about freedom a lot on this weekend, 4th of July. And we ask, O Lord, that this freedom can go beyond even that of our country, the United States of America. But our freedom to love one another can go throughout all places in this world, because all people belong to you, O God, and you have given them all gifts of your Spirit so that we can further your kingdom in this place and beyond in eternity. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated as we continue with the reading of our lesson. Thanks, Ron, for reading once again.
The reading this morning is from Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 16. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work. Then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride, for all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand? It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy and upon the Israel of God.
For our gospel. The gospel for this day is according to Luke chapter 10. Glory to you, O Lord. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, peace to this house. And if a person of peace is there, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to me, to you, listens to me, and whoever rejects you, rejects me, and whoever rejects me, rejects the one who sent me. The 72 returned with joy, saying, Lord, in your name, even the demons submit to us. He said to them, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. Indeed, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. The good news, the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Will you pray with me? Most gracious God, as we gather here in your presence, we give thanks for this place, a place where we can hear about your new creation and how the kingdom of God has come near. And we can also hear about the gifts of the Spirit that you have given to each and every one of us so that we can go out from this place, sometimes like sheep in the midst of wolves, and declare your peace, your freedom to all people. Oh God, may your Spirit be at work here in this place and beyond, because your presence is there as well, and your kingdom has come near. In Jesus' name, touch our hearts. Amen. Oof, that's a lot of instructions to give to all of you. Those instructions, how you are to go out from this place. There's been a lot of talk these last few years about how we used to gather in our churches, and the members would just keep coming and coming and coming. I talk a lot about a previous congregation where they used to talk about this pastor back in the 60s when new members would come very freely and easily into a church. They would say that he'd drive by the local grocery store and he'd wave, and the next week there'd be at least 10 new members that would join the church. Well, we realize that that doesn't happen anymore these days. In fact, we've finally realized that we can't just sit here and wait for people to come to us, because the majority of people are not coming to church anymore. So how do we reach them? Well, it seemed like it was no different back in Jesus' day. Jesus sent them out. He equipped them to go through the doors, to walk out into the streets, and to declare his good news, declare a word of peace,
to those who were in the midst of destruction, in the midst of bad news. Declare that the kingdom of God has come near. Well, can we do this? It sounds as though we don't need a whole lot for the journey. We're not supposed to carry a big backpack full of clothes and all kinds of toiletries and things that we might need on that mission trip, you know. We're supposed to just go out and wait for them to provide the food for us so that we continue declaring that the kingdom of God has come near. We know that it's not easy. You know, there's wolves out there. There's snakes out there. There's demons out there. You heard all of that, didn't you, in the end? The power of the enemy is most certainly at work out there. And yet, if we fulfill our calling, we can rejoice. We can rejoice that our names will be written in heaven. Oof, that's a lot to take in, isn't it? And yet, there are so many times in our scripture where it tells us that it's not about us. It's about those gifts of the Spirit that we sang about in our opening hymn that we have been given. It's not about our faith, but it's about thy faith that we'll sing about later on. Great is thy faithfulness, remember? Because sometimes great isn't our faithfulness. We don't always go along with what we think we believe. We hear that so often, don't we? I read about that. I wrote about that in our newsletter this week. I'm sure you've all read it. If you haven't, you can grab a copy out in the narthex. But we talk about how back in Jesus' day, those 12 disciples just weren't enough. He needed help. We know this well. If you've ever served on the council of a congregation or even served on a team of the church, a committee, you realize that there's never enough people. There's always more to do. And there's always that sense of, how come others don't join us? Why is it always the same people that have to do everything? And I wrote about that, how so often, you know, we used to talk about the 20-80 principle in church. And it sounds disgusting, it really does. But 20% of the people do 80% of the work that needs to be done around the church. Or 20% of the people give 80% of the budget. You kind of shake your heads, don't you? But you know, since COVID has hit, I think it's more like 10-90. Sorry to bring you the bad news. But it seems more like 10% of the people are doing everything, 90% of the work. And 10% of the people are giving 90% of the budget. I'm sure Jesus just shook his head. And I'm saying this not out of guilt. I don't want any of you to leave here with even a little bit of guilt. Because you are the choir. You are the ones that show up every week. You are the ones that know that the kingdom of God has come near. But maybe there's some folks within earshot of my words that are hearing what Jesus is saying. We need you. So what did they do? They went out and called, in some passages it says 70, the calling of the 70. In the New Revised Standard Version, they needed two more people, you know, to go out two by two. So they called 72 others, and they gave them instructions and said, go, get out of here. We need you. Go out two by two. Declare the message of Jesus, the message of the kingdom of God, that it's coming near. And they did. We've done that same thing in our churches, haven't we? We've tried everything to get more people involved. We do gigs and we do gimmicks. We entice them. We do drawings. Whatever it might be, we try to get them to come so that they can hear the message that the kingdom of God has come near. But yet we still hear those words that say, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. I hear this so often these days. Don't you? Someone told me a few weeks ago that they went up to Walgreens to get a prescription. And they went up there and it was closed because they didn't have a pharmacist. They didn't have enough workers to keep the place open, so they had to close early. Someone else was saying they went up to Kentucky Fried Chicken because their mother just loved Kentucky Fried Chicken, and they were going to have chicken for dinner. And they got up there. There weren't enough workers. The doors were closed with a sign on it. Sorry, we closed early. How often does this happen these days? Where you hear that we don't have enough workers to do what we need to do. No wonder in the church we struggle with finding volunteers to sign up to serve communion or to read lessons that Ron enjoys reading every week or to do whatever else that needs to be done. But yet I rejoice in that somehow or other when we get to communion, you people just show up. You come up here and you're ready to go. And that's wonderful. But I know there are many pastors out there that like to be a little more organized than I am, and they like to have their ducks in a row and know that someone is going to be there when they need it. Thank you for showing up in those places. There's so many exciting things that happen. And as a pastor, the most thrilling times that I remember are when a congregation has a big project going on. And somehow that big project looks almost impossible to do. They just won't be able to pull it off. And they do. The people gather together. People from near and far, people that come to church and people that don't come to church. And they all get together and they put together those hours and that sweat equity and they do whatever needs to be done. And when it's over and accomplished, it feels so good. I think sometimes that's how we need to approach this. Not out of guilt saying, oh, we need you. But instead, you should feel the amazing feeling when you accomplish something for the Lord, knowing that the kingdom of God has come near. And when you've done it all together and you work together as a community, wow. You can't describe that in human words. And yet, this is what it means to follow Christ with those gifts of the Spirit that we have been given. I use the example of the trees out here in the front. You might have noticed there's a little more sun coming in now. We had a couple pretty big trees out there that were dead, and they needed to come down. Of course, like usual, you know, churches, when they know they can't find enough people to volunteer and do what they need to do, then they start asking for a little more money in the offering plate so they can pay for those jobs to be done. And that erases that feeling of joy when you do something for the Lord. But when the bid came back that it was $1,200 to cut those two trees down, of course, some people thought, oh, that's not bad. That's pretty good. You should see what I paid for my trees. But a couple people stepped up and said, we can do that ourselves. And they did, with the help of some ladies who provided food for them. On a very hot day, two trees were cut down, and then our yard looked just terrible. There were branches there were big stumps all over the yard. And I thought, oh no, that's going to sit there all summer long. I had to go out of town, and I came back later in the week. It was all cleaned up. And I understand that there was a crew of people that got together with three or four trailers, and they made several loads, thanks to Murray as well, who made those loads, and they accomplished what needed to be done through volunteers. That's the feeling that I'm talking about. That's what Jesus is talking about when he calls the 72. We need you to come out. We need you to go out there. You've been given the power of the Spirit to take care of those demons, those wolves that are going to come upon you, and you can bring forth the kingdom of God. You can bring peace to people, a peace that the world cannot give, but only God can give. And all of this can be done as you're sent out. I always think about that, though, sometimes. You know, churches, they all get together and meeting and gathering and committee and team and congregational meetings, and they all get all fired up, and they're ready to go out there and do whatever needs to be done. This comes from a comic. And they get to the door, and it's locked. They can't get out. Sometimes that happens. We get all fired up, and we get out there, and we can't get out the door. We can't do it. It doesn't work. And again, that's when we go back to those gifts of the Spirit, that yes, indeed, they have been given to us to make a difference, to do something good, to bring the message of the gospel. And we don't always do it for the rewards. You know, you always hear that. Your reward will be great in heaven. And then we become martyrs that do everything we can so that we can get to heaven. And we as Lutherans know that we don't get to heaven by our good works, do we? We can't buy our ticket to heaven by helping so many people. We need to know that Jesus has already opened the door, the gate to heaven. By grace, we have been saved. So that should be enough to fire us up to want to do something in return for God. That's what we miss out on sometimes in our Lutheran understanding of belief, that indeed we have been saved already. That doesn't mean we want to sit back and watch. We've been saved. God has done everything for us through Jesus on the cross, dying for us. So now it's our turn to give back to God. Because we have been loved so much, we've been called through the freedom of the gospel to love one another wherever they might be. I worry, as you worry, about this country, this world, the divisions, the hurts, the pains, the destruction going on, the shootings, the decisions being made for us, those things that we don't understand. And yet, we've lost that spirit of gentleness. Did you hear that when Ron read that in that first verse? My brothers and sisters, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. A spirit of gentleness. We could say that over and over and over again, couldn't we? And then we hear those words as we move forward, as we hear the call to go out, to bring peace, to bring the kingdom of God to others. We hear, so let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever you have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. My brothers and sisters, the kingdom of God is near. Amen. It's not about our faithfulness. It's all about God's faithfulness to us. We sing, "Great is thy faithfulness." Please stand as you are able. Affirm this great faith of ours with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the community of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now gather together to join our prayers
as they ascend to heaven to Jesus. And there will be some silence during this time for you to pray as well. You're welcome to pray out loud if you want to. If you want to name some names or some struggles you might be having, please do so, either out loud or in the silence of your heart. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give thanks for this day. We give thanks for the 4th of July and what all that means since 1776, that indeed we have had the freedom to believe in you, in our faith, in our own lives. Oh God, we give thanks for all who made this possible for us. And we ask, oh Lord, that we not blow it, that instead we go out and share your message of love, forgiveness, and good news with all that we encounter. Lord, in your mercy. Oh God, there are many who are hurting. We pray for them throughout this world, throughout this nation, this community, and this congregation. We pray for people like Dorothy and Paula and Pat, for Darren and Norma and Ruth, for Bill and Eric and Kathy, for Dwight, for Nancy, for Noel, for Dorothy, for Blake, for Mary, for baby Opal, for Cherise and Lila and Kathy and Agnes. We pray for others. We name them either out loud or in our hearts at this time. Surround all of these, your children, with the power of healing, the power of peace that only you can give, and the faith to believe that whatever happens, we are in your loving arms, and nothing will ever separate us from your love. Lord, in your mercy. For those who have lost loved ones most recently, or it's still very tender in our hearts, we pray, Lord, that those loved ones are with you, that their names are written in heaven, and that one day we talk about that reunion, that time where we will be reunited with those who have gone before us, and all the saints will gather at your table and feast. Feast of fine wine, feast of rich meats, great breads. Oh Lord, we thank you for making this possible for every one of us. And we pray that as we carry on the legacy of those who have gone before us, that we too can love like they loved, and more importantly, love like you love, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy. There's lots of things going on out there, Lord. We pray that as you have called us and given us the gifts of the Spirit, that you have made us stewards to be in charge of this creation, that we can fulfill those duties. This means something different to everyone. So now we take some silence to pray for those ways that we can perhaps uphold our call to be in charge of your creation. Hear our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. There's so much for us to pray about, Lord. And we can continue our prayers as we receive communion today. We pray that as the harvest is most certainly ripe and ready and full, that we can become a part of that harvest. We can become a laborer, and we can know the true feeling of joy when we do something for you, knowing that you are always with us and you have done everything that needs to be done so that our names one day will too be written in heaven. So God, continue to give us strength as we are nourished at the communion table, and as we respond to your love, may we continue all week long in that response to you, because you have done everything for us. In Jesus' name, we lift our prayers. Amen. Please be seated as we take a moment now to receive our gifts and our offerings and listen to the beautiful piano once again. Please stand as you are able once again. Good God, we give thanks for the gifts that you give to us, that we can give back to you at least a little bit of those gifts. Because now again, as we share those with you and those with the kingdom, you give us even more. You shower us with your love. You give us Jesus, his body and his blood, so that our sins can be forgiven and we can look forward to living eternally with you and with others. Thanks be to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We think of Jesus in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We join together in praying the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Maybe be seated at this time. Our table is ready, and just watch as the communion assistants come forward. All are welcome to receive this gift, as the bread and wine is meant for everyone. one last time. The body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in his amazing grace. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our closing hymn, O Jesus, I Have Promised. Invited for coffee and treats downstairs. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.